Jehane Noujaim. So, Jehane or Karim, can you talk about the last push you made on this film this summer? You'd shown a work-in-progress version of the film in January at the Toronto Film Festival, and you knew that there was more to be told in this story. So, talk about what happened this year.
This was a very difficult film to figure out what the ending was. I think we were trying to figure that out all the way through. And the first time that we really allowed the film to end, or the film could find its ending, was when Morsi was elected. Because whether we liked Morsi or not, or whether the revolutionaries liked him or not, it was a story from the removal of a dictator to the election of a president. But as we were on our way to Sundance, 2 weeks before we showed what became the rough cut, everybody was back in the streets again because Morsi had declared unchecked powers and was pushing a constitution through. And all of our characters were back in the streets, and the story definitely was not over. And it became a much more interesting story because it became not a fight only against the army, but a fight against fascism, whether the face of fascism was Mubarak, the army, or the Muslim Brotherhood. And so it became a story that we had to go back and continue filming. So everybody thought we were crazy. They were like, you won the audience award at Sundance. How is it possible you're going back to keep filming? But our characters were in the streets and fighting, and it became this story that really we felt the ending was June 30th, when so many people came down to the streets. It was the largest protest, as the newscaster said, she said, in the history of the world. And in one of the most populous country in the Middle East, here you had so many devout Muslims coming down and saying, nobody will use Islam and nobody will use religion to create another fascist state. And that was an incredible thing to see. So we came back and we filmed, and we felt like we really were able to capture the end of the emotional journey of our characters.
But then again, it was another tough moment, because just that happened, and there was a moment of excitement. A week later, people were slaughtered. So it was kind of like, well, okay, it's not a complete happy ending. There's a reality that's difficult. And I think that's always been kind of the issue with the Egypt narrative, from a filmmaker perspective, but also from a news perspective, is that it hasn't fit in a tidy box of like what we want to see revolution meaning, which is this very romantic idea that people come down and they pull down the government and they have this happy ever after ending where the new perfect president is elected. But that actually never really happens. And I think that was a big struggle with making this film.
Take some questions from the audience right there in the middle.
Just a question about your portrayal of the square. Obviously many extraordinary and beautiful things happening there. There was also a lot of things coming out about, sexual assault in the square and these other kinds of issues in the square. Do you feel these were exaggerations, accurate? Did you encounter kind of other sorts of impressions? Was there a kind of a side of this beautiful movie that also had a kind of darker undertone, or how do you feel about that?
The question for anyone did hear in the back is, there were a lot of reports about things happening in the square that were unsavory, including a lot of sexual harassment. What are your impressions of that?
Sometimes the square was full of life and full of people that were fighting for their rights, and sometimes the square was lonely and empty, and sometimes the square was a dangerous place to be, and the revolutionaries had a difficult time dealing with that because this was, an attempt to, there were thugs that were sent in, there were people acting on their own, there was a lot of sexual assault at different times in the square. Actually, one of the people, our sound guy, is somebody who helped to start an organization called Tahrir Bodyguards. And so he's actually in the square at any time there's people in it, protecting women, and had started an organization where any time this happens to a woman, there's a group of people that surrounds and tries to prevent that from happening. But definitely, there was a lot of difficult things that happened in the square, including sexual assault.
There's actually no end to this story, really.
Exactly.
There's no happy ending, there's no sad ending, there's no end, because as we know now, such irony with what your character said in the movie, the army has taken over. I mean, they got rid of Morsi, but they're now in power. So what's happening next? What's happening right now as we sit here and watch this movie?
I think that's a very good question, and a lot of people have that concern of like, what is the end? I think for us, what the end is that it's at least where our characters get to, because we can't with this film claim to be writing the history of Egypt or the history of this revolution. It's way too large of a story, and we're just taking a perspective of the square as this journey. And I think that the realization that people come to is that it's not about who's elected or who's not elected or what political battle is won or lost. Those are just moments in time, you know, like as you see a president comes in, he comes out. It's more about a level of consciousness that if you can let citizens realize that they have a responsibility in their society to be active participants and that that is the way forward, then that is a much greater goal than any kind of political victory. And so I think that what our characters reach to is that it's about keeping the spirit alive among people, to continue to claim their rights, to continue to exercise their rights, and to not allow for any group to take that from them. So I think that is kind of where the story ends. And in terms of what's next for Egypt, I think that it's not going to be pretty, it's not going to be tidy, but I think that there's enough people in Egypt who are going to be unwilling to settle. And that's the main thing, is that people don't settle. They don't settle for what, for the future that they deserve.
I think it's a struggle every day for people like Ahmed and Khalid and Megdi to not be pulled into these binaries, and it's a struggle for every Egyptian. But what you see in the film and what our hope is that the friendship and the fact that people were fighting for a world that was not dictated by the military or by Islamists, you know, people are still fighting for that. And I have a deep optimism when I see a friendship like that able to continue. And I see that not only in this film, actually. I have actually seen that among other people that I know in Cairo.
Yeah, I think that also, you know, the one part of the message that we're trying to accomplish with the film is to remind people emotionally about the journey of what's happened, the different moments, you know, and to remind people that in the beginning it was about everyone. It was never about your political identity. It was about people coming together and standing together to say that we are here. I'm a person and I exist and I deserve to be here and I deserve better. And it was a voice, like Ahmed says, it's people found a voice and that voice became very loud and it was able to move mountains, so to speak, and it did, and it achieved a lot. So I think that what we can hope for is to continue to inspire people to come back to that moment, to come back to that realization, understand that what's happening is much bigger than, you know, one political view or another. And one thing I would like to do is, Ahmed is in Egypt, but he wanted to send a message to the audience. So if you would like to do that, can we do that?
That's a long distance bill.
We don't follow the rules so well, as you can see.
Spent 2 years, it's been interesting going through, currently we're going through these distribution decisions, and I've spent 2 years with people that have fought so hard for their rights, and so we're calling back to Cairo and talking about whether we're going to do theatrical or whether we're going to take it online, or, you know, and Ahmed will say, you can't give up those rights. Tell them you can't give up those rights. No, you know, so I think we've become even more adamant about our... All right. Okay. His mother, by the way, just watched it for the first time as you guys were watching it. So, his mother.
Hello.
الناس هنا كلها هنا وعايزين
His name is Ahmed Hassan, and he's very thankful that for each one of you who came today to get a glimpse of the history we've been living for.
He hopes that everyone who came today understood that the people are the base of the power in any place in the world, and he hopes everyone knows that. And that the people are the ones who always pay the price for the oppressed, for oppressed powers. So, and he says, and now, you know, we've decided, what happened in Egypt is we decided to stop paying that price and to stop having being in control of our future and being unwilling to give that up to anybody. We paid a huge price to get to this moment, and you know the price was blood, but it won't go in vain. He says his main message that he wants everyone to know is that, you know, after going through all this, is that there's a revolution inside of everybody. That every individual has a revolution inside of them, and that it's an amazing force, and something will trigger it one day. But that the caution is, be careful that when you do go through revolution, don't lose your humanity, because it's your humanity that allowed you to get to become a revolutionary or to experience revolution to begin with. So that's what he'd like to send to them.
She's still watching it, but she called me, and she's completely moved and can't speak watching the movie. And she says she hopes that everybody in Canada loves it too.
All right, we have time for one more question, right here.
Yes. Have you shown the film in Egypt, and will you be showing it in Tahrir Square?
Yeah, I mean, we've shown the older version, which was done right. Like we finished this film that you guys just watched literally the day before Toronto. It made many people in the festival nervous. We actually brought the tape in hand. So we haven't had the chance to do a major public screening, but there was a, you know, we were trying to do something where we would have a screening in Tahrir happening while here, but. The square right now is the situation right now in Egypt is not easy to have a kind of public screening on a message like this. But obviously, I mean, this film is made by Egyptians, a huge crew that's unbelievable, and it's very important for us to get this film out there in Egypt and across the world. And one message I know from the crew we'd like to give to you is this film was made by everyday individuals coming together. There was no pre-production, there was no plan. We were in the square as protesters. And we hope that...
We all met each other in the square. The entire crew met each other in the square.
So we hope that, you know, we feel a responsibility in getting this message out there, and we hope that the one thing every member of this audience can do is to also keep that voice alive. So keep the voice alive that was born in Tahrir Square, that so many people paid the price for. Tell your friends, tweet about it, Facebook, just, you know, help us keep getting this alive. This is a completely independent thing, and we want as many people to experience this as possible.
Also want to remind you to vote if you like this film. You can take your ticket ballot and put it in the vote box outside, or go on to tiff.net/vote. Just two more days of great films at the festival. I think Jehane and Karim will probably be on the sidewalk outside. You could say hi to them. Thank you very much for coming. Thanks especially
to TIFF13.